Hey guys, it's Jacob Nadav from BellyProof. I'm here in London. It's rainy outside, and I thought I'd use the time to make a little video, sit by the window, get a bit of fresh air, and explain to you a little bit why I think you shouldn't worry about calories. One of the most frequent questions I kept getting when I did my own body transformation is how many calories did I eat? You might be asking the right guy, but I think you're asking the wrong question. So I don't know. I don't think calories are relevant, sorry. And obviously that got me into weird conversations, because even with fitness professionals, they kept asking me that and said, what do you mean, calories deficit? Eat less, train more, etc., etc. And I'll explain.
The very basic thing we're told about weight loss is that you need to burn more calories than you take in, or in other words, creating a calorie deficit. Besides counting calories, we also have the concept of high metabolism, low metabolism, and your BMR, which means calories burnt at rest. This may sound simple. Work hard to burn more calories, eat less to get less calories in, and ideally from high quality foods to get all the vitamins, minerals, etc. in order to keep your metabolism high. Nice and simple. But is it? Here's some other stuff we know. We know body fat breaks into free fatty acids in what's called fat breaking or lipolysis. We know low glycogen, exercise, lack of sleep, poor gut health, and too much stress all produce cortisol, and that excess cortisol makes us store fat. Ironically, we also know that low glycogen and exercise are conditioned to help us burn fat. We know that the breaking of fat tissue happens primarily with adrenaline and growth hormone, which you get more of when you recruit muscle fibers from type 2B, unless your insulin levels are too high at the time, because insulin interferes with growth hormone production and is directly associated with storing fat. We know the pancreas triggers insulin secretion when it senses a rise in blood sugar levels, and it is influenced by insulin resistance, insulin sensitivity, fasted states, and more. We know glycemic index measures how fast certain foods raises blood sugar, and that insulin help us clear that blood sugar by activating glucose transponders on fat cells. We know belly fat has unique properties like restricted blood flow, high amount of cortisol receptors, and high amount of alpha-2 receptors, which makes it far more stubborn to lose than the rest of our body fat. Importantly, we know alpha-2 receptors can be inhibited while insulin is high, which slows down the breakdown of fat tissue in the belly compared to the rest of the body. We know that aerobic activity burns fat when it has been broken, and burns glycogen and water when it hasn't. We can cover other stuff, from testosterone and estrogen to your thyroid and probiotics, but I think that just looking at this wonderful mess in front of you, you can now begin to understand that calories are as real as, well, unicorns. They might do if you're just taking your very first steps into fitness, but seriously, counting calories is like waving a flag saying you still believe in the tooth fairy. You know, because it is so much easier to believe in a simple idea than to question how it fits into the evidence we have. Unfortunately, that belief in calories and ignorance of hormonal reactions don't really have a place if you are serious about weight loss and belly fat. But you know what? Let's make it more interesting. Let's assume the scientific evidence just don't exist and revert back to counting calories. Do the numbers even add up? They told you that every pound of fat equals 3,500 calories. So in essence, they ask you to look at the food you eat and the calories it contains versus the exercise you do and the calories you burn. This is really nice, as it maintains the illusion that you can actually count that. But what they forgot to tell you is that you can't actually count it, and here's why. First, it's how we measure the calories we take in. The legal margin of error for food labeling is 20%, and in many cases the margin of error is much bigger. So that means those 1,000 calories you were planning to eat today might in fact be 20% or higher, i.e. 1,200 calories plus, which means in a way you can't fully rely on what it says on the pack. Second, there is not a single accurate way to measure the calories burnt in exercise. You can guess it or estimate it. You can have a machine estimate it for you, or even your new digital wristband, but unfortunately, you can't really count it. So, counting calories? Ah, surprise! It's impossible to count calories, but well done for guessing. The other thing is that those calories you think you've just eaten don't always absorb the same way. True, sometimes the food you eat turns to energy, what you like to call calories. Sometimes the very same food end up in your stool, and unless you count the calories in your poop. Other times, food doesn't actually absorb in your gut like it should, which can inflame your gastrointestinal tract, bloat you, and release a ton of cortisol into your system. And even if that food was low calories, it can lead to less recovery and more fat gain if it goes through that process. Think this is bad? Stay with me. If I gave you two products, 50 grams each, one of them contains 450 calories, the other one contains only 200 calories, you would assume the higher calorie product will make you fatter, right? At the same time, in a parallel universe far, far away, most of you already know that eating low carbs can be a great starting point for weight loss. And here's the problem. Fat is 9 calories per gram, and carbs are 4 calories per gram. Multiplied by 50 and you get the quoted numbers of 450 versus 200 calories respectively. So, if you know that diets which are low carb, high fat are indeed good for weight loss, you have to understand that you're talking about a higher calorie diet. High calories and weight loss. Huh? Isn't that like the exact opposite of what they told you? And what about low calorie drinks like diet soda? They have no calories. How dare they defy the system and make us fat? Do you see what I mean? Let's go a bit deeper into the roots. Ever heard of the term glycemic index? Most of the research into high GI, low GI was done in the context of diabetics and pre-diabetics looking at blood sugar and insulin resistance. And it's kind of like two people arguing about white bread versus brown bread, till a third person comes along and says, well, bread, maybe you shouldn't eat bread. Yeah, seems there are three sides to every story, which is why it's hardly surprising that many bodybuilders often have pre-diabetic signs like decreased insulin sensitivity, considering they eat 6 to 8 meals a day. But they will tell you it's to keep high metabolism by ingesting food constantly. Sure. And it's quite interesting to see where a lot of this research is coming from, because a lot of it is funded by companies who want to sell you food. So, let's pause for a second and think, what are calories and who came up with that? So yes, calories, we use them to measure the energy stored in food. If you look a little bit deeper, you'd find that they were originally used to measure the energy needed to heat 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius. Yes, this is what a calorie is, water heating measurement. Now, is it at all possible that by measuring the energy in food, which dates back 2 centuries by the way, and then making all those massive conclusions towards weight loss, we got a little bit carried away. How carried away? Well, probably one of the biggest examples is starvation mode, or the fear of your body slowing down metabolism, storing fat and degrading muscle tissue. This has long been proven wrong, both in the Minnesota Starvation Study in the 1950s and more recently in 1992 in a military research led by Carl E. Friedel. If you went ahead on a course to become a personal trainer or a nutritionist, you would still be taught today that starvation mode is a real thing lurking in the shadows and you should be scared of it because it'll slow down your metabolism, you'll pack on fat and you'll lose muscle and you'd be a mess. Now, starvation mode in a way does exist, but it's a very extreme state. But that doesn't bother the fitness industry, which still teaches people it's just around the corner. What do I mean? Well, one of the most associated things with starvation mode is the concept of breakfast.
Breakfast is the most important meal of the day. You shouldn't skip breakfast. Why?
Because it'll slow down your metabolism. What is metabolism? Oh, wait, I don't know. See, there is a lot of money in the food industry and it does affect what you hear. Who said skipping breakfast is such a bad idea? Is it possible we're influenced by food advertising, trying to convince us we should never go hungry, because being a little hungry is a horrible thing, at least according to the tooth fairy. And if you've done intermittent fasting before, then hopefully you know what I'm talking about. Look at it like that. Who do we resemble more? Mechanical constructs, say like a car, or living constructs like mammals?
Well,
I can say for a fact that while you may not be a whale or a cheetah, you're most definitely not a car. And of course, when you look at nature, a cheetah or a lion wakes up every day to breakfast, beans on toast, or cereals. Ha, they wish. They wake up hungry and hunt. By the way, hunting is intense physical exercise, and nobody hunts if they don't need to. More so, most animals in nature, once they feed, they rest. They don't feed and then say, oh, I need to work out because I'm going to lose muscle. So yeah, animals do intense physical exercise better, whether it's working out hard or whether it's hunting, when they're hungry. My very last point is that while you can confidently say good nutrition and good exercise are important, the mainstream theories don't always add up. There are plenty of examples of lean people who don't get enough deep sleep, become hungry, and eat a ton of calories and yet stay lean. Some of them even went to the extremes of food challenges, like the 10,000 calories challenge in one sitting, what you might call a cheat day. Look at them. Most of them, they're not obese, they're not fat. On the other hand, there are many individuals that gain weight almost regardless of what they do. The smallest piece of cake and the world is upside down, and many of them will admit that people have the audacity to call them lazy despite eating well and training. It doesn't mean it's genetics, and it doesn't mean that they can't improve the way they work, but it does mean that the assumption that it's just about calories is false. When we eat better and train and it doesn't work, we tend to blame it on genetics and metabolism. We fat shame and call people lazy, and more often than not say, oh, it's just motivation, just keep going, go harder. Go on the same sort of thinking that never got us far in the first place. Maybe we shouldn't obsess about the calories if things don't add up. Maybe we should also look at other ideas. There are a lot more good points to be made here, but please take a second and think about it. Why is it so trendy to talk about calories and metabolism? This is a dead-end conversation that doesn't actually factor for the biological processes that takes place. Why not talk about the biological processes instead and how to optimize them? Why, whenever something doesn't add up with calories, do people tend to bring up, oh, it must be a low metabolism or high metabolism? Metabolism is the sum of all biochemical reactions in the body. So, this is the concept of talking about metabolism, or the sum of all reactions, without understanding the reactions themselves.
I want to put some stuff in perspective. Look, if you've never done any fitness in your life, you're obese, you're eating for a family of five and you're eating junk food, sure, maybe you can eat less and train harder and you'd lose weight. I have no problem with that. But if you're trying to get serious, if you're trying to lose, you can't talk about maximum weight loss by counting calories. And I'll say more than that. If you're reducing the human body to calories in and calories out, then you're doing it a pretty grave misjustice. The body is far, far more complex than that. And look, we don't know everything, okay? Science doesn't know everything. I don't know everything. But we know a lot. We know calories don't count for most of the biological processes. We know macronutrients are a better way to quantify food than, and I absolutely agree you need to quantify food. You can't eat as much as you want from whatever. That's not what I'm saying. You do need to quantify food, but why use calories when you can use macronutrients? I think we should stop oversimplifying things, if I'm honest. I think we're way oversimplifying. We say, oh, you want to lose weight? It's just about the way you look. It's just eat less and train harder. Be in a calorie deficit. You can't really take the human body and reduce it into calories in and calories out. There's a bit more to the story. Now, look, I'm going to put some info down the page. And look, guys, feel free to ask me anything. I'm here. I'm not anonymous in any way. This is me. I don't claim to know everything. And I think if you ask me good questions, I will research. I will come back to you with an answer. So that's it for me. Hope it was helpful. And have a lovely day.